Hi, I'm Joe Cook. This is Travis Brungart. We're with Catalyst Construction and we're back at our Waldo Pretty Good House. We started out with doing the comfort board below grade, covered that, and then ran up our foundation walls. Since then, we've framed our house up. We've done our air and water, and it's continuous air barrier all the way up the walls, right over the roof. So now that that's solved, we're getting ready to do our comfort board on our exterior. We're gonna put exterior insulation on this house as well on the walls and on the roof. We're really excited about this assembly. A lot of things to play into it. We have window flashing details. We have how are we gonna support our rock wool, how we're going to attach it to the wall, and then how we're going to put stucco over that after we're all done.
Yeah, it's a lot to consider, but frankly, that's why we're doing the video, right? So with code compliance moving this direction, all homes in the US, well, above climate zone 2, I believe, are gonna have to have continuous exterior insulation. And certainly we're trying to do the best we can for our clients, not just for the folks that are paying us to build the house now, but for the future homeowners, because this is a generations long view.
And prior to code compliance, we've been exploring the possibility and trying to convince our homeowners of using an exterior insulation. And our main reason for doing that is providing a thermal break. Travis and I over the years have been discussing exterior insulations and the problems and benefits of different manufacturers. And we chose ROCKWOOL for basically three reasons. It's vapor open, it's water resistant, and it's pest resistant.
So what we want to do is accomplish, just like we have continuous air and water control, like Joe mentioned, we want to accomplish continuous thermal insulation so that from the earth all the way to the sky, we are wrapped up in a nice warm flannel jacket. And that's what the comfort board's gonna do for us. So with 2 inches of comfort board on the exterior wall, you've gotta consider the window flashing details like Joe mentioned. Window bucks are an issue, we'll talk about that. Certainly anytime you pierce the control layers for water and air, for any mechanical penetration or wire, you have to address that as well to keep continuity of those control layers. As we go up the wall and over the roof, that gets a little easier, not a whole lot going through the roof, plumbing vent, things of that nature. But we'll cover all that in today's work. And with that, why don't we get to work, Joe?
Yeah, let's get rocking.
Yeah. So Joe, let's talk folks through this step by step, because I know that it seems really simple to some, but there's a lot of us that didn't start our building careers doing this. So let's keep it simple. What's the very first thing we're gonna do to get this board on the wall?
Put your safety glasses on.
Ah, good man. Thank you, Joe. Appreciate the safety. Gloves, because this is a stone wall. So as we cut it, small particles will move into the air. I don't necessarily want to take that into my eyes. If we were working inside, I'd have a mask on. We have such dilution with the outdoor air. I'm not concerned about that. So I got my safety glasses on. I got my gloves. How am I gonna get this from here to there?
Basically, you just stack it. And if you're doing a long wall, you wanna stagger your joints, but you measure it, cut it just like you're cutting with a regular saw, stack it, and it's real quick to install.
Well, let's get it done. We've got an inside corner that we're working to, as well as an outside corner. So I'm just gonna go ahead and measure this to 81, and the world is imperfect. I wanna go ahead and go high and low and confirm that I have the same dimension at both, which I do. Joe's gonna show you a trick. One of the nice benefits of the softer fibrous product is that I can literally just drag the blade of the tape and scribe that line. I don't need a straight edge. I don't need a square. I don't need to go grab six other things to make this happen. All I need is a tape measure and a knife. Now, if I was smart, I would have had Joe do this because he's right-handed. I'm left-handed. We should have swapped spots there, Joe. But we'll see.
I think you're doing just fine.
Yeah, even someone who's not ambidextrous can make this work. I'm just making it look like it's harder to cut than it is. The other thing you could do, which I guess we could have shown, Joe, you can actually put the board on the wall first and then cut right along the face, just as if you were doing drywall. It's a common procedure. You put drywall over an outside corner, score the backside with your knife, snap it. This is not a thin product. It's more durable than drywall. So we can't do a score and snap, but we can definitely cut it in place. If that saves you labor and time, by all means, do it. We're builders. We're out here trying to make a profit. So you want to take your time when you need to take your time and move fast when you need to move fast. Our next procedure is going to be to measure and cut around this window. From our board that's already in place, which is going to act like a shelf, just like our rim board did down below, I'm looking at 8 3/4. We go 8 3/4, and then we also want to measure our inside edge here. We 5 1/4.
5 1/4.
And then we're going to go up above it. So we're actually going to cut out a square in this because we're above our line. And you can see that we've got carpenter stationery all over the place here. So we're just going to go ahead and use our carpenter stationery and make this simple. So we were 81 overall. We're going to go ahead and cut this square out. What were we, 5 1/4 here, Joe?
5 1/4.
Joe's the numbers man, so I'm always grateful to have him double checking when I say something, I don't get it wrong. We were 8 3/4 underneath both edges. And so now all I have to do to figure out this top cut is run the tape up to 48, because this is a manufactured product. It's very consistent in its shape, 96-48. I'm gonna slide this out just enough to set on my shelf here, make a mark at 48. Oh, you know what? That's not gonna work, Joe. That's gonna be too small of a piece to hold together.
We're just cutting it out.
So we'll piece it in above the window with the next board, friction fit that in there. So we'll just go ahead and run our cut all the way up. And the nice thing about working with this product, again, you don't have to be perfect. It's always good to strive for perfection, but we live in the real world. Things are gonna be just slightly out of square here and there. You're gonna have your window tape essentially creating an 1/8 to 1/4 inch of variance where it's layered over. And so rather than fight for that, gosh, we gotta get this exactly right or it'll never fit. This isn't building cabinets. What you're doing here is getting it tight. It'll compress a little bit. So if you cut it to say an 1/8 too big, you can force it on there and the fibers will compress a little bit. Now, 1/4 inch, you might not be able to compress it that much. Like I said, it's rock. So you can't compress it endlessly like you could a big fluffy bat of fiberglass that frankly doesn't offer the density, any of the other benefits. But you do have to be pretty close. If you overcut it though, you got an easy path to fix it. Take your cut off and stuff it in there, because this is a dense product. It doesn't require a giant airspace within it in order to do its job. Joe has already scribed all this out while I was running my mouth. Pretty typical for work on our jobs, right, Joe? Somebody had to get the work done. But with his scribing, I can quickly blow through this with my left hand. There we go. Set that aside. And now this is a little bit delicate because it's such a small cut, so we'll work together to place it. And you can see we've got a nice edge here. If I need to shave that to tune that up to get my stucco corner clear, I can do that, just scribing the blade up. But now with this in position, Joe can just go ahead and fire that in. And frankly, that's probably enough to hold it, Joe, but if you want to throw another one in there for safekeeping, our board on this other wall, that's going to push that in, so we have really no risk. And then before we completely close out, obviously this is a completed installation except for this little 3/4 strip that we'll do with the board that goes above it. This is probably a good time as any to talk about the rain screen that's going to go over this. Because you'll see, we've only put two fasteners in this. Two fasteners to hold these boards in place. The reason that we're doing that is we're adding an additional layer of rain screen over this. And that's a great practice. Rain screen is always a good way to help manage for water. We're gonna wrap this with it's a Delta Dry and Lath as the product, but any rain screen strategy, you could use furring strips that are made out of wood. There's a lot of different rain screen products on the market. But because we're gonna be attaching over this with a rain screen, like if you're using a wood furring strip, you would just run right down the stud line with say a 1x3 or a plywood rip, a 3/8 fir would be fine. Just something you can nail your cladding to. When you apply that furring strip over this product, that's going to help hold it on. That's your structural connection to hang your cladding from. This is not a structural connection. This is just what's holding this in place until we get that rain screen in place.
Now that all your windows and doors are in, properly taped and sealed, you're ready to start putting up your comfort board. One detail that we really like is we extended our mud sill by 2 inches to give an extra support of our comfort board. It's basically so when you start standing your boards up, you're not struggling to hold them up and in place. You just set it right on that sill and then you can start fastening.
In order to be efficient about your work, you're going to want to take your materials and stack them where they're going to be close at hand so you can work fast. You'll see that as we stand these up, like Joe said, on that 2-inch ledge, we've got the flashing tape rolled down over it. It's been adhered, it's a pressure sensitive tape, so that's been done. And you can quite literally set the board on the ledge, line up the edge, and we're gonna use a ramset gun that's gonna drive a nail through the comfort board into the sheathing. It doesn't even have to hit the stud for this temporary first hold it there in place kind of install. It's a through insulation fastener that has a plastic sleeve with a little cap that you can fold closed over the nail head. And that allows you to further isolate that thermal bridge. So the metal of the nail is highly conductive. If you had it all the way out to the face of the insulation, you'd be transmitting that temperature difference through that conductive surface. This plastic sleeve is basically using air as an insulator to eliminate that.
You'll notice with our ledge detail, it does not wrap around the entire house. It's for a real simple reason. We're putting a deck on half the house. So what we have here is this temporary 2x4 is representing our deck ledger. This is our wood-to-wood connection that we have to have for our structural engineer. So we're gonna run our Rockwool right down here. It's gonna land on this and we'll fasten it, pull this off. Our framer will come back, put a half inch spacer up, put the deck ledger, and that Rockwool will go right down to our framing so we can get as much continuous insulation down. After that, our decking is actually gonna run into the Rockwool. The backside here, right on the other side of this concrete, we have the comfort board, and then we're gonna fill it in with bad insulation right here. So our thermal envelope goes down from the bottom, up the wall, into here, and straight up.
So it's a basic layout, measure from point to point, cut your material precisely, which is easy to do with the tools that we use. Certainly Rockwool Saber is an excellent choice. Grip-Rite makes that little handsaw. We got a Baco saw that our friend Ben Bogie recommended to us for the thicker insulation products. But this is something you do with a handsaw. It's very easy to lay it out, make your cuts straight, put your material on the wall, and then you move on to the next sheet. And you just work your way around the house. For efficiency, you're probably gonna do your full bottom course all the way around, as if you were laying brick, and then move up the wall with ladders. Because you're gonna have to use a taller ladder leaned against the wall and bring the material up underneath. You don't wanna lean your ladder against the material, unless it's like a step ladder where it has a closed top. If you used an extension ladder that has 2 points of contact, that's gonna push into your insulation and mess up the nice work that you just did. Working bottom up means less extra lifting. Using an extension ladder allows you to pull that material up and set it on the new ledge that you've just created with the comfort board, nail it off to the wall. We're just gonna use a couple fasteners, again, for the first course, because we're gonna do a full through fastener detail when we put the rainscreen material up.
With a lot of construction details, corners inside or out can be an issue. Not with this product. It's basically you just butt it and you butt it tight. Straight cuts, you can cut it a little bit oversized because Rockwool will compress. I don't know if I'd recommend that with the 5-inch product, but with the 2-inch product and any of their interior insulation, cut it just a little oversized and it will just fit like a tight glove.
We want to be tight with our insulation from ledge to bottom of window and around the side, because anywhere that you don't have insulation touching insulation, that's where air is moving through your assembly and you've broken the continuity of the product, which is the whole point.